This is Wanping and Marco Polo Bridge on, what's the river?
Yongdinghe River.
And this is significant. This is where we are now, inside at the museum, which is in the center, because in 1937, Japan, the Empire of Japan, crossed over and made their way to Peiping, Beijing. This was the southwest entrance to the city, which is surrounded by mountains on three sides. And then to Tianjin as well, I think. They use the pretext of a soldier being lost to cross the bridge. And before that, you know, going back to 1931, Northeast China and North China had been colonized by Japan, and the Sino-Japanese War was 1894-5. Taiwan and Korea were annexed by Japan. But July 7th, 1937 is the beginning of full-scale war, and shortly thereafter, Japan invades Shanghai, and the CPC and KMT, the nationalist government under Chiang Kai-shek, the Kuomintang, KMT, and the Communist People's Party under Mao and others, had to finally cooperate with each other and end their civil war and form a united front to fend off Japan. And China became a very important pillar of World War II. That's why they have a Security Council seat on the UN now, permanent Security Council seat, along with the United States, Britain, Russia, France. There's five members on the Security Council. Dumbarton Oaks Accord, which we get to later, talks about all that. But Marco Polo Bridge, which they call in Chinese Gulu Chiao. It was described by Marco Polo in his journal, his travel journal. And there's a stele when you go up to it at Kangji and Qianlong. About the full moon at dawn or something over the water. If you watch my last video, which goes over the first room, and then here we're talking about some of the campaigns in North China. Great Wall anti-Japanese campaign. Japan wanted to depopulate North China to make room for colonization, something like they had done in Hokkaido after the Meiji Restoration. And I think they wanted to focus a lot of the Chinese families along the Great Wall, is what it said in another part of the exhibit. The Chahar Campaign. North China Incident. 1935, Second Manchukuo. Manchukuo is the puppet government they set up with the Manchu emperor from the last emperor. They go into all that history in the movie with Peter O'Toole. They were setting up a second state, I guess. A second Manchukuo is what they were doing with the Chinese emperor. Manchu Emperor, when they established the puppet government with him at the head, because he had been ousted in 1911, so he was used by the Japanese to try to form a population base against the nationalist and the communist governments, which were at civil war with each other through the 1920s, there's periods of warlordism and civil war in China following the fall of the Qing Dynasty in 1911. Sun Yat-sen never really got to be president because of that, unfortunately. December 9th movement. This is a movement that took place to galvanize Communist Party members to form a united front against the Japanese. The KMT, realized that Japan probably couldn't take China. This is my understanding, that Japan probably couldn't take China, and so they could sit out the confrontation somewhat on the sidelines and then fight the winner. And so the KMT had a policy of non-aggression towards Japan's annexations in Northeast China. And then in North China itself, they did put up a fight in Shanghai, however, because that's where Chiang Kai-shek had his factories. The Sui Yuan anti-Japanese campaign. But they eventually have to put their differences aside. Xi'an incident, the primary emergence of the KMT and CPC's cooperation. So Xi'an is the ancient capital of China. And the topography of China is really what allowed guerrilla warfare and stalemate detente with Japan through most of the 1940s till the end of the war. China formed two armies from the Communist Red Army, the 8th Rao Army in the north and the 4th Rao Army, which fought around the Yangtze River in the south. There's Mao as a young man. Peaceful settlement of the Xi'an incident. They essentially, I think, put Chiang Kai-shek under house arrest until he agreed to cooperate. They talk about it here. December 12, 1936. Preparations for the National Anti-Japanese War. And they do resume fighting right after the war ends. And Chiang Kai-shek leaves with his tail between his legs to Taiwan with the remnants of his army and air force. He takes a lot of the national treasures with him to the Taiwanese Museum as well. KMT, CPC cooperated in the face of danger. July 7th incident, that's Marco Polo Bridge incident. Lu Gu Chiao. It was the seat of Wang Wanping County here in Beijing, which was then Peiping. Peiping. There they are marching through. So the Japanese, you know, always had a subtext for what they were doing, even though it was outright colonialism and empire building. And to a certain extent, they say they have the Greater East Asian Co-Prosperity Sphere. Sometimes you'll see a map with a big bubble around Japan at the center, and they're protecting the Pacific and South East Asia and East Asia from, you know, the Western powers, which were divvying up China. So there's some truth to the fact that their colonial efforts, you know, at the war in 1894-5 against China, they took Port Arthur, say, from the Germans or the Russians, forget which one, but both, they took land from both powers. So essentially they were taking some land back from Western colonial intrusion, but they were, you know, full-tilt military-industrial colonial complex into the Meiji era, and they didn't have the white man's burden on top of it. They had still had the Bushido code, where if you are conquered or allow yourself to be captured, you're a coward and you should be tortured, etc. So there's a lot of atrocities that were committed, and that's one thing that is still a very bitter pill between China and Japan, the recognition of the atrocities that were committed during this war. And they refer to the war as the war against, war of resistance against Japanese aggression, not World War II. Luchuan Conference. CPC promulgated its line of the total resistance by the whole nation. I can see why Japan is very resistant to, you know, certain things and distrustful of the West, because the history has been that it was sliced up like a pizza pie. There's a famous political cartoon that you'll see of like a British bulldog, an American eagle, a Russian bear, a French frog, a German, I don't know what, a rising sun, all converging on China to piece by piece take it apart. So we all had our colonial interests in the Middle Kingdom. And somewhat still do, because China produces so much of our raw materials. They probably have half the world's supply of precious, not precious metals, but all the little things you need for your cell phone and computers and all that. The rare metals. Rare metal things like all the stuff you need for electronics and Declaration of the Kuomintang, CPC cooperative issued, National Anti-Japanese United Front formed. More of the same about the cooperation between KMT, CPC. Marching to the Anti-Japanese front line to resist invaders together. New Fourth Army, South China. The exhibit downstairs, I don't quite understand the greater contributions aspect, because it's essentially a small exhibit of this. This is Yunnan province, where they established the headquarters of the CPC, the national government of the Communist Party, during the war years. Yan'an, excuse me. Is Yan'an in Yunnan province? No. It's in Shaanxi, right? Yan'an?
It's not Yunnan.
Yan'an. Shaanxi?
Yan'an, Shaanxi.
With two A's or one A? Shaanxi or Shaanxi?
Two A, Shan.
Shaanxi, yeah. The Yan'an Lighthouse.
You know, Yan'an is another symbol for like CPC when they were establishing their spaces in China.
The capital of the Shaanxi, Gansu, Ningxia border area. Okay. Yeah. So it's on the border, kind of, huh?
Yeah, kind of border.
So out of reach of the Japanese for the most part. So, the CPC, well, the 4th Army and the 8th Army, at first are engaging in direct battle with the Japanese, and then they kind of fight them to a stalemate and switch to guerrilla tactics and rearguard actions against the Japanese, and thwarting the Japanese attempts at colonization and forming a Chinese population that was subjugated to Japanese rule through politics, re-education, enforcement of military martial law, essentially, by the Japanese in most cases, and massacring, really, a lot of massacres. They'll have a map later that's really heartbreaking, and a lot of photos, too, of just how much China suffered under the hands of the Japanese. We had one or two battles in the Aleutian Islands, I think, with the Japanese on American soil, but nothing like what China had to endure. An observation group from the American Army with Mao Zedong, Zhou Enlai. American journalists became an important part of the story, for disseminating what was going on to the wider world. Edgar Snow, Agnes Smedley were Americans. Bertram was British. So they go into guerrilla tactics. Establishment of the anti-Japanese bases in North China. Shaanxi Chahar Hebei military area. The 115th Division of the 8th Route Army. I think they had the 115th, 120th, and 129th Divisions. Three divisions. Yeah. Shenyang was an important piece of the empire for Japan, going all the way back to early middle Meiji, because of the coal, is what I read when I was in Chiba last month at the Museum of Japanese, National Museum of Japanese History, Chiba Prefecture. Establishment in any Japanese bases in Central and South China. In China, Japan takes over Hong Kong from the British, not the Chinese actually, and Singapore as well from the British, not the Malay or Singaporeans at the time. Actually, the first cracks of anti-colonial movement of the 50s were sown by just how easily Britain crumbled under the bicycle onslaught of the Japanese. Can you believe that? They used bicycles to overrun the Malay Peninsula in a couple months. Fortress Singapore. Yeah, right. It shows you how the illusion of power is often enough to keep people in line. Culture and education, construction in the base areas, launching the People's Guerrilla War. So a lot of homemade stuff. I mean, they were living a hard scrabble life, not without newspapers, though. And the rudiments of a strong central government. But it'd be decades before China could implement what Sun Yat-sen laid out in his treaties for developing China into a modern industrialized country. And they're still working on it, but a lot of ways they surpassed some of the Western countries. Like, the rail network is amazing. Rectification campaign. Mao Zedong talked to cadres during the rectification campaign. I guess this is like they had some entertainment here. It wasn't all hard work. Persistence in the United Progressive War of Resistance. KMT implemented a policy to dissolve and guard against and limit the CPC after the North Anhui incident. North Anhui incident, huh? Anhui province. Opposition to surrender and separation, retrogression. So again, political infighting between CPC, KMT. Puppet regime found at Nanjing. President of the KMT, Deputy President Wang Jingwei. Zhu Di. All forces mobilized to contribute to the war of resistance against Japan. All parties circle reunited. What was the Anhui incident, do you know? The Anhui incident. Yeah, this is when they break their alliance, the KMT and CPC. Anhui incident in, did they give a date? Because they're cooperating for the first couple years, late 1930s, it seems like, and then they dissolve the political military alliance. Oh, hey, no one's playing with it. Let's do this now before someone starts playing with it. So it's all in Chinese, but you step on this and it shows you different areas that light up. It's a map here of China. There's Taiwan. Hainan province, Korea is over here. This is the Pearl River. This is the Yangtze River. And this is the Yellow River. and Bohai Sea. I don't know what that river is. There's some kind of plateau or valley here in the middle to Upper Yangtze. And this is the Qinghai Plateau up here, right? That's why China wants Tibet, because of the source of water. They're building a connection between these two rivers now to bring water to Beijing from the Yangtze River. Here, let's do this before someone starts playing with it. Which one is this?
This one is 90 bases built by CPC. All of them. And this is each of them.
Which one's this?
This is Jinshui, Shanganyang.
Let's see, now someone else is going to do it.
Jinchaji. You just flash it. Shandong, Dongjiang, Xiang'e, Eyuwan, Suzhewan, Suzhong, Huainan, Huaibei, Jireliao, Zhedong, Shubei, Wanjiang, Wanjiang.
Down there. Yeah. Hey, no, no. So these are all military bases.
Yeah.
And then what's this central valley here on the Yangtze River? Where's that? What province?
Sichuan.
That's Sichuan?
Yeah, Sichuan province.
Ah. Where's Yunnan province? This one?
Yeah.
And that's Sichuan.
Guangxi. The name after these two provinces, according to the Yangtze River.
Yeah.
The north of the river is called Hunan. Sorry, south. South. Hunan is south.
Nan is south?
North. Yeah. And then we have Zhejiang,
Fujian, Jiangxi
here. Yeah. Anhui, Jiangxi.
What river is this up here?
Which one?
This one on Russia.
This one?
Or yeah. This one.
This one?
Yeah. Where's in Inner Mongolia where your mushrooms were from? Uh-huh. Where's Tibet? Here? This is Tibet?
Tibet's
here.
Here?
Xinjiang province?
Yeah.
Is this the Qinghai Plateau?
Yeah.
Qinghai?
Yeah.
Qinghai Plateau. Is this flat area?
Yeah.
Or all of it?
No. Qinghai
Plateau. Is this area here? What do they call this area, this flat area in
Xinjiang?
That's Xinjiang? Cool.
It's not mushroom, it's fungus.
Fungus, it is mushrooms or fungus. Yeah. So these are the tunnels that the gorillas used to frustrate the Japanese. Villagers supporting the Red Army. Let's see, around the world, I think we're looking at stuff here. Let's see, numberless masses mobilized. So this is an airport that was built in Chengdu, which is Sichuan province. Donated planes, naming ceremony. Let's see. Anti-Japanese arts and literature were developed. Higher education restored. This is probably the most interesting section we're coming up to now. Since we were talking about this earlier, when I visited the Yasukuni Shrine, which is a national war memorial in Tokyo, it's for all of Japan, their war museum there goes over a lot of this history from the Japanese perspective, but it leaves out the atrocities that were committed, sadly, which I think is a disservice to parties on both sides, the soldiers who died on both sides, to not tell the full story of what happened. And it's created bitter tension between the two countries. Like when Shinzo Abe there visited the Yasukuni Shrine, it was in all the world headlines. Over 900 cities, and that's not including all the rural areas where there was wanton massacre by Japanese forces. Innocent people cruelly maltreated, killing of captives, enslaving forced labor, bacteriological and chemical warfare experiments were conducted, and it was all part of a policy, that was written and established by the militarists in Japan to, for instance, get Chinese people addicted to opium again and turn them into coolies, working in factories and mines to support Japan, the Empire of Japan, and their war efforts. And so I think this is, why the argument in the United States, you have the same shit. There's still people in the South with the white trash mentality of the Civil War was not about slavery. It's like, it was clearly about slavery, and there's this revisionist history to try to get away from that. Clearly about slavery, and they come up with all these other reasons for the war to be fought, and they don't talk about the real main reason. There might have been other influences happening at the time, but the one main influence was suffrage and rights of, African Americans. To not talk about it at all in a national museum of military history, it's kind of a slap in the face, And so that's what they're showing here, all the different cities where horrible things. 1931 to 45 is a 14-year period. World War II is a much shorter period in United States history. For us, it's the end of, December 41, so really 42. To 45, what is that, to 3 to 4 to 5, 3 years, of war, 4 years. And no home fronts. So the Rape of Nanking, 37 to 38, after Japan captures Shanghai, they march on the capital, Nanjing, and go to town. Empire of the Sun shows some of this, I think. The Spielberg movie. Burying people alive. Manslaughter matches. I don't know what those were, but I can imagine. Corpses and mass graves. Mass graves are what we usually use as evidence now, like in Yugoslavia, for the war crimes. If you have a mass grave, usually you have a war crime that was committed. Either that or some kind of Ebola plague, There's no reason for people to be buried in mass graves unless they're all killed at once. And the only way that happens in modern society is disease or war. Bodies of Chinese people murdered by Japanese troops of Xiguan near Yangtze River. Hebei Province, Panjiayu, had a massacre. These kids had their parents killed and house burned down. Can only imagine what happened to them. Villages burned by Japanese troops. Hunan Province, Changjiao, 3,000 civilians killed and raped, 2,000 women. There's the bodies. Heavy bombing. So because they put up a, KMT puts up a resistance in Shanghai, Japan just carpet bombs Jibei and the north areas there of Shanghai, which is ironic because that was referred to as Little Tokyo because of all the Japanese living there. This little girl's outside the main railway station, or the South Railway Station, which has a museum now in Shanghai, to the rail. They had a really cool map of Japan there, of China too, at that museum. Aircraft bombing, big tunnel tragedy, thousands of people died of suffocation, June 1941. Commercial press bomb destroyed Japanese troops, 1932. Tianjin Nanke University bombed by Japanese troops. We commit atrocities too. We carpet bombed cities in World War II in Germany. We dropped atomic bombs on Japan. But we don't deny that it happened. Were they closing? Chengdu. We haven't even gotten to the comfort girls yet. Thorough plunder. This is them bringing back hordes of goods to Japan from North China. Train loads of coal, gold ore. Things they loot from civilians. Torture, murder women and children. Planned as a whole. They had these comfort women stations. And they have photos here as evidence. Japanese troops raped more than 20,000 Chinese women within a month after they seized Nanjing. That's a medium-sized town. Chinese women, first raped, then murdered. Japanese troops. Here's the director of Women's Salvation Association. What they did to her. Comfort women were set up in brothels. And men lined up here to go in. And these poor women were rescued. These children were murdered. Liaoning province. It's in the northeast. Qingdao, they had their bellies cut open and hearts removed by Japanese troops. It's like, why would you even take the time to do something like that? Politics, economy, culture, enslavement and poisoning, supporting war by means of war. Chinese people were devastated. Spiritually, physically, weakening and disintegrating Chinese people's resistant willpower was the goal. Education of children with propaganda. Re-education. Check out this torture device. They'd put you in this cage which had spikes on the inside. And then they would roll you around. See the spikes in there? Shackle you. So this is why it's kind of nasty when you go to the Yasukuni Shrine and they say, Japanese soldiers were very disciplined during the war. And they give like a few instances of places where they may have acted with, you know, rank and file discipline, but they ignore the thousand other places they didn't, you know? It's like, oh, really? And you don't expect people to get pissed off if, you know, Prime Minister goes to visit it every year. Japan compulsively exploited more than 20 million Chinese laborers from 31 to 45. Kidnapping. Working in the mines, building fortresses. Laborers engaged in work in Hanoka, I think that's in Hokkaido. They're trying to industrialize Hokkaido, the North Island of Japan at this time. A lot of ruined samurai had to get transplanted to Hokkaido as well for work. There was a revolt led by this guy. Crematorium by the 731 germ unit. They conducted frostbite experiments and germ warfare experiments. Students. Gas masks, so obviously chemical warfare was being used, which was outlawed by Geneva Convention after the trench warfare of World War I showed that it just kind of leads to inhuman stalemate. This is the Hall of Heroes, which leads to the second part now. I guess these are all people who died. And there's lots of stories peppered in to the exhibits there. Women who drowned themselves in river rather than be captured. Men who jumped off cliffs, a couple of whom survived rather than get captured. Are they closed? Bloody battles. This just shows some of the rebel stuff. They defeated or captured a supply train in the Northern Territory using guerrilla tactics, and it showed the Japanese weren't invincible. Tier Zhuang, Shuzhou. Hey, close, okay. Hundred Regiment campaign. Fifty-year struggle, Taiwan. They go through Taiwan and Hong Kong's struggle against the Japanese because Taiwan was annexed in 1894 after the Sino-Japanese War. Hong Kong had a underground guerrilla movement, I guess, CPC party. Allies with the United States. I was hoping we'd see the Doolittle picture somewhere. Then they get into the CPC committee founding. There's the Missouri. Surrender aboard the Missouri. Here's the Greater East Asian Co-Prosperity Sphere that they were after, the Japanese. And then the fascist Axis powers. The idea eventually was Japan and the Axis powers would link up with each other as current premier or prime minister. So I didn't get to do as much. There's a whole downstairs exhibit, too. It's essentially the same stuff. But I think I took video at the National Archives in Shanghai of Agnes Smedley, the exhibit they had with Bertram and Red Star over China and all that stuff, American journalists' contribution. So not a whole lot of new info for me, but it puts it in different perspective. And again, to talk about the Yasukuni Shrine, I wanted to mention like my thoughts now that I've been to some military museums in both countries, that I don't think interning the 14 of the 28 who were tried were criminals from Japan, and the Yasukuni Shrine is so bad, since it is a shrine to all the war dead. But then you go inside and you see that it was done out of disregard, not out of ownership of the incidents that they were responsible for, and that's kind of nasty, you know, and you could see why China continue to be upset at their head of state visiting it, which he has to do politically. How would he ever be reelected if he didn't visit it? But, so, he has to go. But I don't, and too, from people you talk to in Japan, it seems like it's not something that's really taught in courses. Like, the United States commits atrocities every day, but you'll see Abu Ghraib on a headline of a front page won't say it didn't happen. We may argue about why we did it, did if it was justified, but you won't ever hear someone deny that it actually happened. So, you know, it doesn't really justify the atrocity, but it makes it easier to accept, you know, if you're willing to at least acknowledge that it happened. But now I'm going to go walk over Marco Polo Bridge while there's still some light.